Greetings, students. This is another installment of the Microsoft Word series. Today we'll be focusing on the Insert tab. Please watch the previous video on the Home tab just to get a basic understanding of what Microsoft Word is and how it works and what it is used for. Okay. So we have the Insert tab, which is located to the right of the Home tag. So let's explore some buttons. We have the Cover Page button. If you do a SBA or you do some form of project, you can insert a cover page just by clicking on the Cover Page button. And they also come decorated, by the way. So you can just pick one that you want to put as your cover page on your document. In terms of enhancing your document or letting the your document have more appeal, it's good to use a cover page. It's recommended. Of course, you know, you would include things like your school name, school code, your name, due dates, and all of those things. So cover page is a good one to use, and it also does not include the page number, which we'll talk about later. Then the next one is the Insert Blank Page, where if you notice when I clicked it, this page here came up. Let me do it again. So I'm clicking, let's zoom it out so that way we can see more clearly. So I'm clicking here. All right. So let's do that again so that those of you who missed it can see it. So here's the blank page. When I click on the blank page, it's going to put another page below. There we go. And to remove that blank page, we simply click on the previous page, press the delete on the keyboard, or press the delete on the laptop, and it's gone. So that's the blank page. So we can use the blank page to add another page. Of course, you won't have to use that button to add a page every time. Simply pressing enter has the same effect as insert blank page. When you press enter and carry the cursor, the blinking cursor, all the way down, it adds another page. And once again, to delete, put it on the previous page and press delete on the keyboard or the laptop keypad. Alright, so page break just basically adds another page, and in some versions it cuts the page in half. So when I click page break, it adds another page break, add another page. So you can use page break to add a page, or in some cases it cuts the page in half. I've never actually used that one for anything, but it's useful to know. Now let's look at the table button. Now the table button is very useful when you're doing presentations, when you're doing reports and other documents. You want to organize your data, your information, in such a way it can be easily read. We can put it in a table. So I click on the arrow below so that I can activate my table options. So we have what are called rows. So rows run horizontal or from left to right. So that's my first row, that's my second row, my third row, my fourth row, my fifth row. We can also add what are called columns. So if I move the mouse pointer to the right, that's one column, two column, three columns, and so on and so forth. So in this case, I am only putting two columns. If you notice, the table looks very scrunched up. If I want to, I can put the mouse pointer over this star looking thing here with the box, and I can hold it down and drag it to move the table where I want it to go. I can go to the corner, the bottom right hand corner of the table. When the mouse pointer changes to a double arrow, I hold down the left mouse button, I drag it down, and I can stretch out the table. Okay, so here's our table. What can we do with our table now? We can do what's called merge cells. Merge cells can be used to set up a title or create an area in the table where there's only one big cell, or where you put two or three or more cells together. So here we have four cells, and by the way, if you don't know, each square is a cell. Alright, so here we have four cells, and I'm going to merge these four cells. I right click, I click on merge cells. So you notice all four cells have become one big cell. So now I can add text. Let me just adjust my font size. I can make it bold. I can change font color. Please refer to the home tab video if you don't know what I'm talking about. Alright, so I've entered a title in my merge cells. I center it, and there we go. Now it's popping, right? So we can also do, instead of doing four cells, we can do two cells. Now sometimes you want to have like a picture, or you want to insert a diagram, or maybe some form of label or something, or you know. So it's good to be able to merge the cells. So right click, merge cells, and then these two cells are also merged. So now I can put whatever I want to put in there. So we can merge as many cells as necessary to make the table look how we want it to look. Okay. And of course, we should know about the undo button. So if we change our minds, we can always undo, and so on and so forth. So the table, very useful option to use in Microsoft Word when you're doing projects and so on, and you want to organize your thing better. Alright, so let's put some more text. So we can add a column for name. We can add a column for what, date of birth. We can add a column for school. And we can add a remarks column. All right, now these are my labels that I'm putting at the heading. I'm going to make them bold. I'm going to make this cell a little bit narrow. Right, so that it pops. See that? I can also widen the table like I showed you before. And let's add some color to it. Now, depending on the purpose of your document, you wouldn't make your tables very colorful unless it depends on your target audience. If it's for children, of course you want to make it colorful to attract them. But for adults, you wouldn't make it too colorful. But just for the demonstration purposes, I'm going to make my table colorful. So I've highlighted the name column. And I'm going to use borders and shading just so I can add a splash of color to it. So I'm making the name column yellow. I'm making the date of birth column a high green. I'm making both the remarks column a blue. And there we go. So we can color our table, we can bold our text, we can center our text, can widen our table, we can add columns, we can add rows. Let's see what happens if we add a row when it's colored. Do you think it will still stay colored, or do you think it would change? Let's see. So I right click, I go to insert, and since it's a row, I'm going to insert it below, and there we go, it's still colored. What happens if we merge a color colored cells? let's see, it became one color, which was yellow. And that's our table now. Like I said, we would make our table this colorful for adults. Maybe for children, and depending on what we're doing, to highlight a particular portion of the table, it would be feasible maybe to color it. So for example, if you were dealing with a total, like if this is a table representing total sales, and you wanted to highlight the total sales columns, by all means, color it. But you don't want to be too coloring that is distracting to people who are trying to see the numbers and figures. So here we go. What happened if we wanted to take off the coloring off the table? Let's see. So I highlighted it. I go back to borders and shadings and I press no color. All the colors are gone. All right, now there's an option in this where you can export data from Excel sheet and paste them inside the table. We're not going that far for this demonstration. We only want to show you the basics so you have an idea of how to manipulate and use these tools. Now let's look at borders. Now tables have borders, each cell has a border, and we're able to add or remove borders as necessary. So this is the border button. If you place the mouse pointer over each button, the caption will pop up and tell you what that button does. So right now it's set to left border. If I click the arrow beside it, I can adjust any border that I like. All right, so let's start. Let's remove the bottom border and see what happens. So I click on my arrow. It says bottom border and it's off. And of course, if I want to replace it, I can click back on the button on the to the left of the arrow and the bottom border comes back on. Let's try the right border. So I highlight, I click on the arrow and I click on the right border. And look, these lines are gone, or this line is gone. So it's based on whatever you want to do for your table. How you want your table to look, how you want it to be designed. You can simply click on the arrow and take off the left border. Right? And if you wanted to take off one individual border from a cell, we just click, go inside. And then we can click left border and there we go. Now this border is gone. Now of course if we wanted to replace the borders without having to click on the arrow, once it is set to the particular border that we want, we can just highlight it and then just click it again. Suppose we only want to bring back a part of it, we highlight the part that we want to bring back. Click on the arrow. Right click. Suppose you wanted to bring back down here, highlight, or we could just press right click since it's already set to right click. And if we wanted to replace this border, click back the left button and we put it back in there. So those are borders. So you can take off the sides of the table or take off the sides of the individual cells depending on what you want to do. So that basically does it for tables. You can try yourself to create a table, deleting a table, borders and shading, merging cells, coloring columns and or rows, adding text, expanding tables, reducing table size, and so on and so forth. Please don't be afraid to go and experiment. Remember, you will be called upon during your practical test to demonstrate these things. That's why I'm making these videos. Alright, let's go again. So that's it for tables. Let's move on now to pictures. Okay, so Microsoft Word allows you to insert a picture. And of course, you know, when you're doing your projects, whether it's just a regular craft project or you're doing something for your SBA or school-based projects, it helps to add pictures to it. So here we go. I'm adding a picture by clicking on the picture button. I select the picture I want and I insert it. So my picture is there. The picture will not move. Why? Because we need to change the layout of the picture so that it can move. So I right click on it. I go down to text wrapping. Now sometimes you'll have to go into format picture and select layout and then click on in front of text to get the picture to move. But because this picture is what's called a .gif file, it allows you the option of just clicking on text wrapping, click in front of text, and there we go. Now our picture can be moved. So of course, you know, you don't need a big picture, so I'm making it smaller. We can add text to it, we can label it, we can use it, for example, for our cover page that I was talking about. We can use it to help our projects, to enhance the material that we're trying to present, our SBAs and so on and so forth. So basically that's it for inserting pictures. Let me do another. Insert, click picture, click on the select the desired picture, insert, and there we go. Notice the picture is still not moving, right? So right click. Once you see text wrapping, it means that it's a GIF file. So it don't make sense to go into format picture. I was trying to find one with format picture. This way I could show you how to do that example as well. But it's the same thing. Just click on format picture, go into layout, click in front of text or behind text, or depending on how you want to do it. So I click in front of text and now I'm able to move the picture. Please don't be afraid to experiment. That's how we learn. When you make mistakes, you're actually teaching yourself. So don't beat up yourself for making mistakes. Anyone who does not make mistakes is a very dunce person. The most brilliant people are the ones who made a whole lot of mistakes because they learn. Alright, one more. Insert, picture, select a desired picture, click insert. And here we go, still not moving. Let's right click on it. Still giving us text wrapping. I wanted one with the format picture. Alright, so I just want to point out to you these other options here other than in front of text. We have square, we have tight, we have behind text, top and bottom and through. Now these are the options available that allow you to insert a picture, for example, within the text so that the text flows around the picture. So that, for example, the picture can be behind the text. The text can be close to the picture's borders, or we can just make the text appear square around the picture. Right, so there are various options there based on what you want to do. So you can experiment with them and see for yourself. I'll probably do one or two and show you, but most of them you'll have to learn them on your own since time will not allow me to show you every single detail in this option. Okay, so I'm just going to go ahead and I'm going to click in front of text just to make sure that I can expand my picture, and there we go. So my picture is now expanded. So don't be afraid to experiment. Don't be afraid to try new things within Microsoft Word, and don't be afraid to use these techniques and things inside of your projects. All right. So imagine this is a paragraph in your SBA or in a project and you wanted to add this picture to it. Right now it's set to in front of text. So I hold on the left mouse button, I drag it across and it appears in front of the text. Please notice it's not interfering with the text. It does not affect the text in any way. So I right click, I go down to text wrapping. I click square. Look what it did. It put the picture in between the text. And of course I can move it just by dragging it to place it where I want to place it. Right? Let's try another one. Let's see. Square. Nothing happened for square. All right, let's try another one then. Let's try behind text. So now my picture is behind the text. See, I can still move it, but it's behind the text, so the text is covering up my picture. So you can go ahead and experiment with the rest of them and see what they do. Depending on your needs or how you want your project to look, you will use the appropriate option. Most persons, however, use tight or square just so that the picture can fit uniformly within the text. Alright, so what have we done? Just to recap, we have learned how to go inside the insert tab and use the picture button to insert a picture from the computer into Microsoft Word. We've also learned how to what? Change the picture format or layout so that it can be moved and manipulated on any page. We've learned the various types of settings that we can use to allow the picture to appear differently within a paragraph or on a paragraph or above a paragraph and so on and so forth. We've also learned two different ways how to change these options, whether using the format picture button or right-clicking and using the text wrapping option in the pop-up menu. Now let's look at clip art. The clip art button allows us to add graphics, pictures, objects, shapes of a variety of categories and sizes. To insert any clip art, we simply left click the clip art button, which opens up the search bar. We can type in any item we want. Now please note, I have loaded additional clip art on my computer, so therefore most of the clip art you'll see on my computer will more than likely not be on yours. So bear in mind that the clip art that you have, it might just be the regular version. Mine has been updated because I install additional clip arts to my software because I do a lot of graphics and picture work and so. Okay, so let's go. So you can pick the clip art that you want and then you can left click on it and it will insert. If you try to move it, it won't move. Right click, text wrapping again. I don't know why the format picture is not working properly, but for some reason in front of text. And then we can use the left mouse button and drag it to our desired position. Of course, this green button up here allows us to rotate. It allows us to rotate the clip art. And remember, you're only limited to your imagination. So whatever you can imagine, you can make it possible. So if I wanted to do, say, an imagery of something, I can do that. See that? Now it looks like a car going up a grade, right? Okay. Alright, so what else can I do? I can copy the clip art, make a copy of it, I can bring to front if I wanted to put it in front of another picture. I can send it behind another picture. Just depends on the effect I'm trying to create. Let's try adding another. And we have different categories, please. All you need to do is just type in the search parameters that you want and then just click go and it will search. But like I said, your version might not have as many as mine. I installed like 11,000 on mine. So I have a lot on mine. So there'll be a difference when you go on your computer. Or you can try and download them as well. All right, let's go. Let us try and put in another clip art, something that matches our theme. So I left click, Right click, text wrapping in front of text. Now I can move it. Right click in front of text. So now I can move it and have the effect that I want. I can make it bigger by holding one of the ends and dragging it out to make it bigger. I can make it smaller by holding the end and pulling it in. It all depends on what I want to do, right? So you can go ahead and experiment and try to insert some clip arts. Based on your project, you'll know what you can and cannot use. For an official document, please do not put foolishness in there. You wouldn't put this in like a job letter or something like that. But if it's like a project, like a poster or a birthday card or something like that, have at it. But if it's an official document, such as a report, you wouldn't put these cartoonish things on those official documents. Alright, so that's it for clip art. Alright, let's go now to shapes. So we have a variety of shapes stored in the shape button. We have lines, arrows, two-dimensional shapes such as squares, rectangles, ovals, triangles. We have solids, cylinders, you know, cuboid, cubes, hearts, so on and so forth. We have types of arrows that you can use. We have flowchart symbols that you can use. We have callouts or shoutouts that you can use. We have banners, ribbons, and so on. And you can always download more or go and seek more on the internet. But for our purpose, we just need to know how to manipulate these and how to insert them. So let's say we wanted to make a house. Start off with a rectangular looking 2D shape. Then I need a triangle for the roof. Roofs are normally triangular. Then I can put a door, maybe a window in there. Alright, and remember this software is only limited by your imagination. So there's my door. It went behind. I need it to be in front. So I right click, I go down to order, and I click on bring in front of text. And I still not working properly for some reason. Let's try again. Right click, order, bring forward. That looks like it now. Yep, there it is. Normally be on the left. Okay, then I can go ahead now and I can add some windows. You can right click, can copy, left click, then click paste. So I can add my windows, and that's my little house. It little, but it's mine, not true. Alright, so we can hold down the control button, left click on each piece of the shape, and all of these little points will light up. Right click, then click group, and now it's become one, so I can move all of it as one. So a very brilliant student asked, "Sir, can we use this software to design plans?" Yes, I've seen people use it to design plans. It's limited though, but I've used it to design even beds and tools and all different kind of stands and tables and those things. But you can use it to design a house plan. However, the better option would be to use AutoCAD. That's what engineers use. So it's a better option to use. Alright, so we can add other things in there. So the star, we can put the star in a circle, and notice that the points there are highlighted, which allow you to drag them in, make them small, make them large. All right. So the problem I had before was I wanted the doorknob to come in the front. Now I want the star to come in the front. So I can click on the star and bring it forward, or I can right click on the circle and send it back. But first, before I send it back, let's color it up now. So I right click on it. I go down to Format Auto Shape. Here is Format Auto Shape, finally working. Color lines. Notice that you have a fill color and you have a line color. You also have a line thickness and line type. All right, let's go to the fill color. The fill color, we have all these normal colors here. If you want, you can have no color, or you can add more colors. It depends on what you want. You can customize colors, make your own colors, and so on and so forth. Not going that far though. So you can go and explore and experiment. So I click on fill, and I'm going to make this red, and the border, the line color, which is the border of the circle, I'm going to give it a high green. I'm going to turn up the thickness up to about 3. I'll change it again to show you how it looks. And this is the style. These are the various styles that they have. We can have double, so on and so forth. We can also have a dashed line. We can also do a dashed line if we want. Let's try all of them and see what happens. So there's my red, there's my green outline. Let's try and send this, which is order, send to back. Now it's gone to the back, and I've brought this forward. Alright, so there I go. And then that's my symbol. Now if I try to move it, if I click on the circle will move. If I click on the star will move. So when I want it to move together, I hold on the control button on the keyboard, click on the star, click on the circle, right click, let go of the control button, right click, go to grouping, go group, and now I can move it as one. Alright, let's change it up a little bit now. So I can right click, go back to Format Auto Shape. Let's try to make the line even thicker. Click OK. Wow, look at that. Doesn't that pop? That pops, right? Right click, Format Shape. Now let's try to make it a little bit smaller. And there we go. It's back to the way it was. Alright. What about the let's try some dash lines and see how the dash lines look. Alright, so dash lines, you have a variety of dash lines that you can use. I don't know if you can see it clearly, but if you look, you'll see that the green line is now dash. The green line that circles it is now dashed. I can make the, if I make it thicker, you'll see it more clearly. There we go. See, it's a dashed line. So you can go in, you can adjust it. Suppose you change your mind, you don't like this color, you can go back and change the line color to something. There we go. And if you want, you can go back and take off the dash and just use a straight solid line or a finer dash. It's all about what you want to do and how you want your project to look. Alright, so there are other shapes there, the crescent moon. You can adjust it by putting your pointer at the one of the points and adjust accordingly. You can use the green button there to rotate it according to your needs. We have other shapes such as the heart. You can use a heart, you can use Valentine's Day, so on, if you're doing a Valentine's Day project. You can also put a picture in there. Yeah. We have lines, which I put the line in there already, and we can adjust the orientation of the line. And by the way, how I put in the line was, I left click on the line button, hold down the left mouse button and drag it according to how I want it to be. So here's my diagonal line here, and here's my semi-horizontal line here. If I want to change its direction, I simply click on it, place the mouse pointer at the end until it becomes a plus. Then I can adjust it, whether I want it to get smaller or longer. I can also attach two lines together. If I want, I can do that as well. I can even make a triangle, which there are the triangles there, but I'm just saying if you wanted to do it, you can. Right? And please remember, these lines are separate, so if you try to move it, they will move. So if you want them to move together, you have to hold on the control button on the keyboard. Then click on all the lines, right click. It's not selecting both of them. Okay, here it is, group. And then I'll click on these two, then click group. And then here I am, there's my triangle made. So this is a custom triangle. Of course, there's a regular triangle in there that you can use. You can adjust it accordingly. But if you wanted to make one specific to your situation, you can go ahead and do that. There are also arrows. Maybe you want to point to something to emphasize. A lot of documents I make, I use arrows. They act like fingers to emphasize something. You want to point, right? What else can we use? We can also use the arrows to make a family tree. Let's make a family tree. Alright, so we're going to make a family tree. What do we need? We need a horizontal line going across. We need some arrows. And I'm using vertical arrows, but you should know that they can go in any direction. Let's adjust the font size. We don't want it to be too small. Alright, let's center our title. So I click on my arrow, I drag it down just to make it a little bit more neat. Alright, so it looks like that now. I can left click on the arrow, right click, copy, left click in any white space, right click, press paste, and there I have a copy of my arrow. If you know the shortcut keys, you know you can press Ctrl C, Ctrl V, Ctrl V, Ctrl V, Ctrl V. Makes it easier to just move faster when you know the shortcut keys. If you're not familiar with them, please go and watch the video or the video about mouse and keyboard skills, or you can go online and just look them up and take a snapshot take a screenshot with your phone and watch them. Alright, so there I go. So I have my arrows, I have my title. So what's Bustamante family now? We have what? Jade. Oh, we always start with jade. Ivory. Topaz. Then we have what? Emerald. We have sapphire. Which one am I forgetting? Coral. Alright, which one is missing? Can move my arrow accordingly. And this is just for my purpose, why I'm doing it this way. You don't have to do it this way. It's just a demonstration. Alright. So we have ivory, Topaz, coral, and I left off jade. I have to stretch this line a little bit just to make it fit. Okay, they're too big. I have to make them smaller so that they will fit. There we go. Yes, that's perfect. All right, so a little tweaking. And this is the Bustamante family tree. Why don't you find a laptop or a computer and make your family tree? Mommy, daddy, grandma, grandpa, sister, auntie, or the dog, the cat, the rat, and everybody unite, just so you don't miss anyone. Alright, so that's basically how we use the lines and the arrows, and we can decorate and make something creative with it. Let's go look at some solids. Alright, so the shapes button in the insert tab gives you solids. So we have the cylinder. This is not the cylinder we use cook. This is the cylinder as in the mathematical shape. So we have our points that we can place the mouse pointer over to make, you know, shorter, to make it wider, looks like a pudding, to make it more narrow, looks like a cup, whatever you want to do. Let's do another shape. We can also add what are called cuboids. So cubes, for those of you math geniuses, you should know, are like squares. They have all sides equal. We can right click, copy, left click, right click, paste, create a copy, and the cuboid now doesn't necessarily have all of its shapes equal. It has two pairs of equal sides, at least two pairs of equal sides. So there we go. There's our cuboid, there's our cube, there's our cylinder. And if you want, you can go ahead and add some more shapes and faces and so on. So you'll see me, this one in my class, I use it for when no students are showing up and I get tired of waiting. I will put up the say sir prompt. Okay, so back to solids. We can change our solid. We can change the line color for our solid. We can change the fill color for our solid. So we can make our solid that color, format auto shape. We can make our solid that color, and we can make our shapes our solid. That color. So if you're doing like a project for like a brother or sister, even when you get older, your children, you can use the solids and add them into the presentation that you're doing and use them accordingly. And of course, Mr. Smiley Face, we can give him a color as well. Usually I make him yellow. Yellow is like the sun, happy, right? Okay, and those are basically your solids. And please remember, this little green arrow allows you to flip it, turn it any which way. You can drag it, push it. You don't need to use any text wrapping with these. You can copy it. Should be able to cut and paste. Still put it same place. I don't know why it does that. Alright. So that's basically for solids. The rest of it now is just basically call outs and arrows, and you can go ahead and experiment and see what they can and cannot do. Just click on them and see. Suppose you work for somebody and you need a sign to say this direction, like as a indicator to say go this way. And your boss wants you to make something like this, you can simply group them together and you can color them up just to give your customers to your business or your boss's business direction. Let's change the color. Let's make it 3. Let's make it stay black. Yeah, black is good. And there we go. So you is this, if this was to be used to like give people direction to say go this way or go that way, that would be good. Or if you want to make up a stop sign, you could do that to say do not enter or so on and so forth. Can change the direction of it. Change the direction of it. Right, so you're able now to add solids, add shapes using the insert tab. And that's basically it. The only thing left are the callouts and the stars and the banners. You can go ahead and experiment with them. All of them basically work on the same principle. All right, let's move on to the charts button. Alright, so the chart button allows you to add a variety of charts that you can use to represent your data if you're doing a presentation using PowerPoint, or if you're just using a projector to speak to a larger audience, you can use charts like pie charts and so on and so forth to get your data across. Now, the pie charts are charts in general. Work with the data that you have in Microsoft Excel. That's how it works. Now, when we do Excel, I'll actually do charts, but I just want you to know that you can create a chart using Microsoft Word, but you have to put the data in Excel first. So when I do the videos on Excel, Microsoft Excel, then you'll see how to create a chart. We have what's called a header and footer. So the header would be the top of the page. Whatever you type in one header appears in all the headers on each page. So if you wanted to, for example, put like a page number at the top or something like that, you can type in or a quote or something like that, you can type it in the header. And then we can do what? Press enter. Let me zoom it out so you can see more clearly. Right. Press enter and go down to the next page. Notice both of them say the same thing. And once you put it in the header, it will always show up in the header. Alright. We also have what is called and of course you can also add decorative headers, so you can go ahead and experiment with these and see how they work out for you. I don't normally use decorative headers, but if you find it necessary to help your document pop, you can go ahead. Then we have what is called the footer, and the footer is the footer complements the header. If the header is at the top, then the footer would be at the below. So I can add some text in the footer just to demonstrate to you that it will appear on each page. All right, my font size is too big, so I'll make it smaller, and then there we go. To exit the footer or the header, just click on any blank space. So as you can see now, my footer is in all the pages. So we can use these to do creative things. It's up to you what you want to do in terms of how you want to use them. But they are mainly used for adding numbers to pages and so on and so forth. But you can add other things in there too. It's not limiting. Please remember once again, once you're doing your formal document, not to add foolishness to it. You can be creative, but to do it in a sophisticated way. Alright, let's look now at the insert page number. Okay, so in the insert tab, we have what's called page number. We click on the arrow, you can put the page at the top, or you can put it at the below. We have various styles of page numbers. If you look at any document I create, I normally use this one. It helps me because sometimes you will have like a 5-page test and you only give students 4 pages. You don't want to make that mistake, so I normally use this type. You don't have to, but I do. You have a variety of styles that you can choose from. So if you want the regular number, you just press the regular number and then it will just be 1. So the second page would be 2. Now when we add the cover page in the cover page button, this one, it would not be numbered. That's why they gave you the cover page, because the cover page is what the person sees at the front of your document. And you ever hear them say you shouldn't judge a book by its cover? So when you make your cover pop, when you make it appealing, it will make people want to pick up your SBA and read it. Okay, so we have our page numbers, and like I said, we have a variety of styles that you can choose from. You don't have to use my style. You also have Roman numerals and so on. You just need to search through it and find the one that you want. Like for example, this, see, puts the color down there just to highlight the, you see it? Right, so, and we could also do that with the header as well. You know, some people find it fun to add like a color to their page, to their pages. It costs more because it's going to take more ink, but you know, just to do it properly, especially in this electronic age, if you know you can email your SBA, then by all means you can go ahead and add a little color to your document. Let's move on. Okay, so next we have text box. Now, I don't really use text box, but you can click on it. You can use it to add any form of text that you want to add. I don't normally use it, like I said, but I'm sure somebody can find some use for it. You'd have to ask Miss Paul or one of the other English teachers when you use text box. I've never used text box. Never had any reason to. Okay, quick parts. I've never used that either. Let's look at some word art. So here's our word art. So I click at the arrow below, and we have a variety of word art that we can choose from, which are all editable, by the way, which means you can change them. So I'm clicking on this one first, and it gives me some text. So now I can type in some text. I can change the font style, font type. I happen to be very partial to Monotype Car Visa. I don't know if you're familiar. You can click on all of them and go through and see what all of them look like. So you can use them appropriately. There it is. All right, so here's my font size. So 36 will be very big. I can bold it. I can take off the italics. I click OK. And there is my word art. Now please notice they allow you to edit the text from here. They also allow you to change the style from here. So if you change your mind and you don't bother want that one, you can just pick a different style. Right? All right, so what I'm using with this is it has that box around it like the picture, which means it will not allow it to move. So you'd have to right click on it, format word art, go to layout, in front of text, in line with text, square, tight, behind text. Sound familiar, right? So you pick the one that you want, and then now it can be moved. So I place the mouse pointer at one of the points and I drag it out, and there we go. Very useful for making posters. We can also right click, format word art, colors and lines. We can change the fill color, or we can change the line color. Let's try the line color first. Anybody can tell why I like purple? And there we go. So our word art now, which is Bustamante, it's purple outline, white fill. Alright, like I said before, we can change the orientation. We can change how it looks. It all depends on what you're doing. You know, it all depends on what you're doing. Some persons use these to make designs for t-shirts. There's an idea. And we can go here and we can choose from a variety of styles that's there. It's a beach setting. Could use this for the beach, so on and so forth. Right? We could right click, we could copy. We could copy it. We could cut and paste it on a different page. And this would apply to the pictures as well as the clip arts. Can cut and paste it anywhere we want to cut and paste it. Alright? And that's basically word art, you know. Edit the text. Suppose you want to change from Bustamante to change the city and guilds. Let's try. There we go. And if we wanted to again, we could just change this back. Right. And basically that's it for word art. Of course, you know this green arrow, green point like I showed you. Can turn it left or right, can rotate it. And that's basically it for word art. Suppose you wanted to put the word art in the header or the footer. Think that would work? Let's try and see if it would work now. I want to see if the Alright, so how do I do that now? I'm going to right click. I could cut and just paste it, but I want to create the copy. I open my header. I paste it. And look what happened. Look at that. Now it will appear on every page. Just by putting it inside the header. It can appear on every page. So once I did a poster with a teddy bear like that, and I put messages inside the middle of the teddy bear belly, which is very creative way to use the header. and the footer. Okay. All right, so let's move on. All right, the last thing we're going to look at now in the insert tab is the equation and the symbol. They're both basically of the same, you know, orientation, where you have the basic symbols here, mathematical symbols that is, that you can put inside your document. You know, divide button, plus or minus, not equal, pound, yen, copyright symbol, and omega, and the sum of symbol, and so on and so forth. You just need to click on them and they will appear on your screen, and you can adjust them accordingly. Pound, we couldn't use some pounds, not sure. And I don't mean fat. Alright, so we have equations. We click on the equation button. Here we have our regular operators in mathematics. Square root, plus, divide, minus, multiply, and so on and so forth. We also have the ability to put in a fraction, to create a fraction. You can create a fraction. If we want to change it, we can just click back inside of it and go in there and change it. If we want to add more complicated fractions, we can add more complicated fractions. Let's say that we wanted to put something with some powers in there. So let's say this is b to the 3, and this is what, b to the 4. Let's add that 4 as another let's add it to this. Okay, and there's our fraction. We can put an equal sign there, and you math said should know b to the 4 divided by b to the 3 is equal to b to the how much? B to the 1, or just b. You don't have to put the 1 there. The answer will just be b, because once the bases are the same and you're dividing, you keep the base on, subtract the powers. So this will be b to the 1 or just b. If you want, you can write the 1. If you want, you can write the 1. But B1 is the same thing. B to the 1 is the same thing. Alright? And we have other symbols in there, some other symbols, other than mathematical symbols. Those are the ones I mostly use. We have Greek letters, letter-like symbols, your operators, your plus, your minus, your multiply. We have arrows, negated relations, we have scripts, we have geometry. So for geometry now, you know, these are your symbols for your geometry in mathematics. Or if it's Greek letters, these are your Greek letters that you would use. Or letter-like symbols. Scripts, geometry. We did geometry already. We didn't do operators. Here are your operators. Remember sets, subsets, and so on. Less than, greater than, less than or equal to, greater than or equal to. All of these are there for you to use, but most of you don't use them. All right. And of course, for those of you who go on to higher mathematics, you have limits, matrix, and you have various type of brackets that you can insert. Let's insert a bracket. I like that. Let's delete this. Let's insert a bracket and see how it works out. All right, so we have various types of brackets. You have the matrix brackets and square brackets and circular brackets and then. Alright, here's our brackets for vectors. For those of you who don't remember what vectors are, go and look them up in the book. So, can turn it into a matrix. And there's my matrix. Alright, so a variety of things are there that you can explore. Just experiment with them. I know most of them you may not know what they are used for, but just experiment with them to know them. Integral, used for advanced level mathematics and differentiation and sum of operators and so on. You can use them. Sine functions, your sine and cosine functions and inverse sine. Those of you who go on to the higher mathematics or CXE level mathematics, you'll also use these functions there. If you do advanced level mathematics, you'll be using these. Okay. All right, so we also have accents. I missed this. Also have accents. I've never used it, but I'm going to try and see if I can use it one day. All right, so basically you can explore, see what they are, even if you don't know what they are. You can go ahead and play with them, see what they do or don't do. By the way, these are difficult to move around. So it's not like the pictures, you have to grab them and drag them where you want them. And then sometimes where you put them, they don't end up going properly. You see what I mean? So you just have to be mindful, and to adjust their size, you just simply highlight them and you can adjust their size accordingly. They're too small. And you get to see the preview in this version of Word. That's good. Okay. Alright, so that's basically it for the insert tab. Please watch this video over and over again till you've mastered it. Don't be afraid to try. Don't be afraid to try and make every effort to practice these skills that I've shown you. This is something that will put money in your pocket. It's not just for a show, because when you have these skills, people will hire you to use them. So therefore, please go ahead and practice them, because at the end of the day, you'll be only be benefiting yourself. Not true. You'll only be benefiting yourself at the end of the day, because you are the one who's going to use these, if not personally in your own lives, at your place of work, or if you start a business, at your business place. And don't be afraid to experiment, because I don't know everything. I just teach you the little bit that I've learned. I teach you the little bit that I have learned in hopes that you will go and practice, in hopes that you will make use of it as best you can, because guess what? It's your life, it's your future, and you can waste it away, or you can try and make the best of it. It's up to you. Okay, so that does it for the insert tab. Please, like I said before, watch this video over and over again until you've mastered it. Try to make it a part of you. These are, unless you're not going into the world of work, I recommend you learn these skills. They're there to benefit you. Full joy the rest of your day.